afternoon.
What's up?
Hey.
Good to see everyone.
Good to have you back, families.
Yeah, good to be here. Our theme for this month is healthy relationships. All of us have relationships in a variety of degrees, no matter if they are good or some are not so good. This being a family ministry podcast, then the first direct implication of that is that of parents and children, which many of us know a lot about. These are relationships that form the family units. And as we know that February is ties everything together, such as love, relationship, friendships, and so on. We wanted to take this opportunity then to talk about these topics, especially as they related to how we can have healthy relationships in our own families.
Yep.
So with that being said, let's get right into it.
Good.
All right. So we're here on episode number 4. I'm joined here by Pastor Jonathan and Pastor Gabe. We're all excited to be here. We're going to be talking about how to have healthy relationships in our family and with others.
That's such a good question. How to have healthy relationships in our life and in our family and with other people. But honestly, though, I think first, before we unpack this, we have to unpack the question of why is this even important? Mm. You know, why is it important that we're talking about family relationships? Why are relationships important? Why can't we just kind of put those to the side? You know, why is this an important question to ask about, you know, how to have healthy relationships with our family?
That's great, because I think a lot of people put time into practicing things like piano or softball, or we put effort and energy into practicing all kinds of things and getting better at different things. We're learning another language, maybe studying a subject, but relationships tend to lean towards just they figure themselves out. At least that's how most humans will kind of approach that.
Right.
So,
yeah. And I see the dangers oftentimes being that the standard in which we view relationships is more subjective rather than objective. And that's especially as a Christian,
for I see that.
Where depending on life experiences or the way we have certain presumptions, even culturally, that's how we view relationships. And I think we need to be reminded, as Christ followers, we have been called to follow the call of Scripture, not of our own subjective opinions.
Yeah, right.
So I think there's a reality here that as we define what a healthy relationship is, we better do so in the right way, in the right foundation.
Right. Yeah. Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And we have to start with the right foundation. You know, I mean, that's a repeated pattern in Scripture. You've got to find where does this start? And that's where you get, you know, we don't want to deal with symptoms. We want to deal with what's the root thing? What's the foundation?
Correct.
Yeah, because I think many times when the relationship goes awry, there's a tendency to just abandon.
Yeah.
Right. And we just avoid and we just we'll just leave that relationship and, oh, well,
that don't work out very well.
Yep. And not necessarily just in romantic relationships, but even within our own family. There's a tendency to say, well, this, you know, this person isn't good for me, or this is, you hear the word toxic relationship. Well, why? Why is it toxic? It probably did not have that healthy foundation. So here, our hearts here at FB First Family Ministry Podcast is to make sure that every rhythm that we practice in our life is based on the truth of God, His word. So what text do you guys think shows us the principle of healthy relationships?
There's a lot. There's so many. It's like,
pick one. Just one.
Before, you know, we each have a text that we kind of chose, right, as the foundation in which we'll drive our conversation through. But the beauty, like you say, Pastor Jonathan, is that, man, the Bible actually gives us the picture of the narrative of relationships all throughout.
Yeah.
I mean, Genesis 2:18 tells us that we are designed with the purpose of with a purpose of relationships. Like when God created man, He sees that He's alone, and He says that it is not good for man to be alone.
Right.
So He creates the helper, right? So we see this beautiful picture of relationships. But the text that we did choose today is Matthew 22. Verse 37 through verse 40. And I want to read it to you because, again, as we found our conversation in Scripture, I think it's important for the Word of God. If we believe the Word of God is the power of God, which we do.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
We want to make sure that the Word of God is proclaimed. So that being said, let me read Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to 40. And if you have your Bible with you, by the way, I want to challenge you, open it up and follow us through it as well. It says this, "And He said to him, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Mm-hmm. On these two commandments depend on all the law and the prophets. We see this beautiful picture of what is often talked about as the greatest commandment ever given, right? And to give you some background context here, Jesus is having a conversation with a lawyer. It's a scribe specifically, but the way the scribe can be translated into our culture is that of a, right. of a lawyer, someone right. who has studied the law, someone who is knowledgeable in the law. And he's trying to have this conversation with Jesus in a tempting kind of way, kind of see, man, I know Jesus knows about the law, right. but let me see how he interprets this in our mm-hmm. culture.
Trying to give it a little trap there.
That's yeah. right. So the heart behind the question can be a little bit shaky.
Right? Yeah, right.
But here's the beauty of God. It's like God uses something that may be intentionally shaky or ulterior motives.
Oh, yeah.
And he uses that for good, right? Mm-hmm. And what he does is he summarizes, right, God's truth in these two beautiful commandments. First, to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And then secondly, to love who? Our neighbors as yourself. These two commandments depend all the law of the prophets. And I love this text, which is really one of the structure of how we're going to be driving our conversation today, because it gives us a biblical order of a healthy relationship. This is what I mean by that. First, before you start looking at your horizontal relationships yeah. with other people,
right.
you have to look at the vertical relationship that you should have, in which you were created to have in the first place, which is Jesus.
That's exactly right. right.
And that's exactly after that, you then start looking at the horizontal relationships.
Right.
And then it gives us the beauty of the imperative that all this is based upon, which is love. And I just love that he tackles those things. By the way, family, if you hear some noise in the background, here's the video of this. This is a family ministry podcast,
yeah.
which means we have some parents in the room. We have a children pastor. So we do have kids here that they're watching in the background. Here's a challenge for you, by the way. I want to challenge you to listen to the background noise at some point and see what kind of show our children are watching. And if you see them on the camera, by the way, it's called Real Life. But that does not stop us from having the conversation
I think that's, you know, and life happens, right? And that's something that we're facing in every day. We have a plan, and then sometimes that plan goes awry. And how does that speak to our own plan for our own life and God's plan being
right.
different
God's
from that,
plan.
Right?
Yeah.
So just like God has a different plan than we have sometimes. Sometimes our children have different plans for the day.
The man. And you know what? We've been called to love them.
No way. I mean, we do. And we do.
That's right.
We do. And they are so good at testing us and you know, but it's a blessing to be here and to have them. And
yeah.
Thanks for, you know, that little.
It's called Real Life.
That's right.
We are here not because we're perfect, right?
Yeah.
Because we are pursuing
right.
God and his truth and to apply his grace and mercy.
Yes.
And part of it is that, hey, if you have a way to have childcare, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. That will not be and I'll continue.
No, that's great. That's great.
So we were talking about vertical relationships between, and we've got to solidify our relationship with God in us first. And what I'm reminded of is, you know, this text actually is something in the Jewish culture called the Shema or the Shema. And this was something that they would recite together as a family. It comes, its origins are from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5 and 6. It says in Deuteronomy 6, 5, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart, shall be on your heart. And so I think sometimes we want to skip to the next verse, which actually that next verse is that command that we talk about often.
Mm-hmm.
We shall teach these things to your children. And that brings us into family discipleship and, mm-hmm. and the priesthood of parents and the importance of parents in the home. We usually tend to just like, oh, well, yeah, now we got these things. Let's show them to our kids. Mm-hmm. But first, we really have to take a look and say, okay, how are these things relating to me? How is God, what is God commanding me to do? Mm-hmm. Through this, how can I truly love the Lord, my God, with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my might? Think about that. All my heart, all my soul, and all my might. And, you know, it's crazy to think. Lifeway did a research study, and they got that 29% of born-again believers state that their personal faith plays the most significant role in their approach to parenting. So that's only 29% of born-again believers state that personal faith plays a significant role in their approach to parenting, which is really important for us. And that's why we're talking about this, is because, you know, we need to prioritize this. And I mean, it's essential that we prioritize our personal relationship with the Lord, our personal love with the Lord, before we start doing horizontal, like you were talking about. So yeah, I think this is really also, you know, another stat that Lifeway got was only 14% of Christian parents and families are familiar with what the Bible says about parenting. And that's really where our heart is with this podcast too, is like, we want to help you, and we know life is busy and it's crazy, and we want to provide opportunities for us to talk to you, to engage the conversation of what does Scripture say about parenting, and how can we ultimately work on this vertical relationship.
That's right. And I love what you said, because it is often, you know, the only way, here's your bottom line, especially as Christ followers, the only way for us to have an accurate, objective, healthy foundation with our children, with our spouses, with our family, and so on, is if our relationship with the Father, Jesus,
yes,
in the right,
absolutely,
in the right way, right?
You've got to,
and that requires us to ask some hard questions, and just being honest. You know, there's oftentimes times in my life as a father where I'm trying to teach my children into doing something correctly or whatever the case may be. And I may do it not in the most healthier way, right? And that's an opportunity for me to self-assess, because often what I see happening is I kind of go back to, I'm kind of responding kind of grumpy.
Right.
Why am I responding grumpy?
Right, yeah.
And what oftentimes will happen is that I have to ask the harder question is, and how am I doing with my relationship with Jesus? Mm. Am I digging into his truth constantly? Because if not, how can I practice the one thing I do not invest in?
Right.
And as a parent, I need to be reminded that I need to go back to Scripture where my foundation is on, for me to truly look at an accurate, healthy view of a parent as a dad. Yeah. If I want to be a good dad, then I better be a good child with my Heavenly Father.
Right.
So it kind of helps us in our heart is that you guys as well would kind of go back. Don't let's not treat the symptoms.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Let's go back to the root of the problem, which oftentimes is, how is my relationship with Jesus?
Right.
Right. So, yeah.
And I think a lot of that stems from the feeling that of overwhelm, right? We pack our schedules and our ideals of what the days are supposed to be like and what activities we're supposed to do. So, you know, for some people, family worship isn't even a conceivable notion, where it feels like, well, we have all these other things to do, and we'll get to that later, right? My relationship with Christ will come later when I have time. Well, now is the time.
You're not going to have
important time.
You're not
going to
have time until you make it.
And all of those things, other things start to peel away as burdens, because you start to realize that relationship is the foundational, fundamental. And once you start listening and becoming obedient, what is important will change in your life. And I know personally, I've experienced that with a renewed faith, you know, into my parenthood, where it wasn't there previously, and it was hard and lonely and a big struggle, to say the least. Yeah. So I think that's really an important point, Pastor Gabe, that you bring up. And I love just diving into this a little bit deeper.
Yeah. I was talking to a kid this past Sunday, actually, and he was telling me, he was like, you know, one thing that I just really love is that my dad, you know, I noticed that in the mornings, he opens his Bible and he reads his Bible. Mm-hmm. And he said, I see that. And I want to do that, Pastor Jonathan. How can I do that?
Come on.
That stuff right there.
Yeah.
That's what's going to, you know, it's not, it, you know, that is so powerful. Seeing your father open his Bible and just read from the Scriptures and just how that relates to that child. Oh my goodness. That's amazing.
And the beauty of that rhythm, right? We all have rhythms. We all have busyness of schedule. We have things to do.
Yeah.
There's things that are very normal, like we wake up, take a shower, drink coffee, right? But when we start implementing a rhythm that is biblically founded in Scripture,
right?
Man, the beauty of that for a child that we don't even realize, like you said that story. Mm-hmm. That's the same story that my wife, right, has told me multiple times. about when she saw her dad the same thing.
Wow.
And she literally will tell you that those moments impacted her so much because it showed her that behind closed doors, in his father's eyes, everybody was still sleeping.
Right.
Well, my wife, when I was a child, so she woke up early, which is, by the way, every single child, they have no comfortable time. And the one time they can't stay sleeping, they decide to wake up at 5 in the morning. Anyway, I'm getting off that road. But the beauty that it is that we don't realize that God is using those moments of obedience for us to found ourselves in his love, in that relationship, we don't even know it's impacting our children in so many powerful ways. So it's an important call for us to, at the end of the day, and I say this often in my student ministry and to others, we haven't been called to be successful. We have been called to be faithful. And as a parent, you feel so many times that you are a failure. I know I do. There's many times that I feel like a failure. And what I need to be reminded is that my identity is on Jesus, that I can love my children because he first loved me.
Right.
That at the end of the day, my call is to be faithful, to obey his truth. And that I pray that by me obeying his truth, God will be using in his greatness and goodness that to impact my children. But it has to start with that relationship with him.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm going to be trying to figure out in the symptoms and not the root of the problem.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I love that. That is so good, man. So good. Miss Erin, what are we jumping into next? What do we got going on? You know, we got.
So the gospel of Jesus Christ is the reconciling work, transforming our life to be in the right relationship with God. And I think, you know, you talking about being a child of God, there's no better way to raise good children than to be a good child of God and obedient and showing that.
Yeah.
And I think something that we struggle with in today, going back to the verse, I'm going to read it because I don't want to misquote it, but
come on,
where we say in verse 39, Matthew 22:39, and a second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So what does that mean, love your neighbor as yourself? We have a very conflicting view of how we should love ourselves in our culture and our society today. And I feel like there's a big agenda, you know, keywords like self-love and self-care and all this kind of have a healthy meaning or intention, but the way that it's implemented and the way that it's focused in our culture is so misguided to where we become our own idol and our own God. And so can you talk a little bit about what the scripture really means there when it says love your neighbor as yourself, and how do you find that healthy sense of self-love while still keeping Christ at the center of our, I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Well, I mean, like, here's the thing is, like, we never once has, you know, a kid popped out and said, Mom, I don't think I deserve a bottle. Don't worry about that, Mom. No, it's like, I need a bottle. Give me my food. You know, and that's the communication. I mean, I don't, like, this is everybody, but you don't have to think twice to think about yourself. You know, I mean, we naturally look out for ourselves as humans. It's part of our human nature. And so when it says to love others as much as loving ourselves, the way that I think about that is, like, I don't have to think about loving myself. That's how it should be for other people as well. I shouldn't have to think about helping other people. I shouldn't think twice about serving. I shouldn't think twice about, you know, building into those relationships and things like that. And that's what my thoughts. Gabe, you got anything that you would add to that?
That was what I agree. That there's a self-centered reality, right? When we talk about that. And here, the beauty of, once again, the order that we're given is that is the second thing that we are to do, right?
Right.
Because it piggybacks, and this one piggyback is founded upon you understanding your relationship with the Father, right? That he first loves you, and because he loves you and you understand your positioning, then you're able to love others accurately. Because what oftentimes can be a danger in society, especially when they push all these different types of agendas, is that that's going to vary depending on people too, right? Like some people have a very unhealthy view of themselves. So what they're going to do is they're going to say, well, you know, I don't really love myself that very much, so I'm going to love other people as well. Or Pastor Jevon, if you said, I love myself so much that I have no time to love anybody else.
Right.
The picture here is that, hey, by the way, like, you made the basis of your love, not necessarily just you,
right,
but you made the basis of your love me.
Yeah.
Like the reason why you can love others because you understand that my love for you is freely given
right.
through the gospel of reconciliation. Right. And we can have that reconciliation with other relationships because of the gospel.
Yeah.
The gospel is reconciliation.
Yeah.
And because we understand that we have been reconciled with the Father, then it gives us those lessons to be gracious, to be merciful, and to view other people in a reconciling way, even if they do you wrong, right?
Yeah. So. Well, and this means that the first question that we really need to ask ourselves is, how is my relationship with God looking?
Mm-hmm.
How am I doing with that, you know? And ultimately, that relationship with God is going to just... everything else is going to flow out of that. It's not going to, you know, be a side. And I think if we don't focus on that question first, then we're just constantly going to be treating yeah. symptoms rather than the actual foundation, the actual issue that's the problem. We've got to work on our relationship with Christ. And you know, maybe even some of our listeners are thinking right now, you know, maybe, man, you know, I don't know if I've ever made that decision before to follow Christ.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if I've taken that first step. I mean, today is the day to do that.
But if you go to church, isn't that...
Yeah.
Honest question.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
I think you
yeah,
know,
no,
Zedek has
yeah,
touched on it sometimes.
Yeah,
where, yeah. I think when we first started coming to the church, one of the things it was kind of funny, but very true. Where he was talking about people in the northern part of the country, like it's very clear. You know, they know whether or not they are a Christian or not.
Right.
Versus a lot of people, there are a lot more churches around. It feels like everybody goes to church, but not everybody is actually saved and knows, has that personal relationship with Christ. So I think that's, you know, that is a very honest and candid question that people have to ask
right.
themselves.
Well, and it's a heart thing. It's like, you really got to look at your own heart. And this is only a question that you and the Lord can really talk through. It's like, you know, you reflecting on your heart and say, you know, do I believe and have I put my faith in Christ? Am I going to follow him or am I going to follow myself? Am I going to follow this world system or am I going to follow Christ? And if you make the decision to follow Christ, man, life is going to be difficult. You didn't expect me to say that, dude. Life is going to be difficult. It's going to be difficult. But also,
yeah.
tell me this, or, you know, also with that, Christ is going to be right next to us. He's going to be with us through the difficulties. Ultimately, we'll have the Holy Spirit in our hearts and in our lives. If we are saved, we have the Holy Spirit, the helper. See, in our times of need, he will reveal the scriptures. He will show us what we need to say to our kids. When my kid talks back to me and I don't have a response for him because I messed up too, God will give me the words to say. He will do that through the Holy Spirit. And so that relationship with Christ, I mean, that's why we took so long, you know, talking about this, because
yeah.
I mean, that's
yeah.
the key. That is the foundation of this whole conversation.
If we get that wrong, everything else doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Because if we get that wrong, then at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is put this face mask that we're going to realize that it fails us.
Yeah.
And here's the thing that's apparent, is that if we put something else as our foundation, what's going to happen is that we're going to be looking ourselves through those lenses.
Right.
And I'm telling you, that's going to be heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to see myself... I already see myself sometimes as a failure, but that's going to make it so much worse, because the one thing that doesn't make me, right, in the eyes of the Lord, a failure, which is him, is going to be out.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, as we think about this topic and as we transition here on the just being intentional in our application, there's a verse that kind of comes into my mind, really, and it's John chapter 13, verse 35, that says this: "By this we all may know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another." Now, I don't want to say this as a pretense to this text. Is this text is talking to the church, right? Same as this podcast, by the way. Although we definitely want those who are listening, this will not make sense unless you have a relationship with Jesus. That's the first step. So before you hear, how can I apply this as a parent, as a dad, as a mom? Answer that other question that we just asked a few times, right?
Yeah.
About how you are in your relationship with Jesus.
Right.
But then here, in the way we apply this is just something that kind of jumped out at me as I was studying. It's this picture how we're called to love one another and how the world is going to see that we are his disciples by how we show that love. And oftentimes that is tied to the church, right? But what if applicationally we view our children in that way? That the way people from the outside sees that we are followers of Jesus is how they see us treat and love our children. Mm-hmm. Now, things get real all of a sudden, right? Because now all your imperfections are under the surface, which, by the way, is okay, because That's a reality of who we are, right? We are broken vessels that we're made whole because of Jesus, not because of us. Praise God for that, right?
Right.
But what if we start having these lenses that views our relationships with our children as that moment where the world gets to see my love, my relationship with the Father,
right?
Right. So,
absolutely. I love that. I love that. And, you know, a lot of people say, you know, family's the first ministry. Mm-hmm. But how many times do we neglect the family? You know, it's, and I mean, this is not a judgment thing, like, at all, you know, like, this is difficult, you know, but it's like, family is the first ministry. We have to prioritize family discipleship, family worship, family care. We have to do that. But, you know, I mean, and that's the first ministry. And we got to do that, because if we're not, then we're not following ultimately the Great Commission to go ye therefore and make disciples. Where do those disciples start? Those disciples start in the home.
Come on.
You know, those are the kids. So.
Yeah. Well, and that's why Deuteronomy 6 calls us to that. Right?
Yeah, right.
It is a hard thing, right? It's a hard thing because what we have to do is then as a parent, right? We have to kind of self-assess and see where am I? You know, like what if all that people had to see my relationship with Jesus was how I treat my children, how I minister as a children pastor, how I minister to the children. Like, what if that was the only thing they could see as a picture of what our relationship with Jesus looks like?
Can I pause you there for a second?
Come on.
That is, as a parent, that is the primary way that people are going to see. Because the majority of people that you interact with have something to do with your kids, whether it's sports teams, at church, when you're going for drop off and pick up, hallelujah for kids ministry, for taking, give it, you know, loving on our kids and teaching them the gospel so we can go fill our cup in church every week. But
speaking of which, if you're looking to get involved,
please talk to me.
We need more volunteers.
We do.
But that is the primary way. I mean, most people I know don't have that outside social life the way you once did prior to parenting, right? So that's how most people are going to see you.
So what you're saying is that that's important.
It's a
little. She's like, I think she's saying like, that's essential.
That is it.
Well, and the question then becomes, right? We know that, right? That we're realizing, and that, by the way, that's the whole point. This wasn't just random here. Our heart is for all of us to realize how important that is and how crucial it is for our daily lives. Yeah. But the question is, how does that apply when it comes to our relationship with our spouses, our relationship with our children, our relationship with our children, with other children, with our family members, right? What does that look like? What are some pictures where we need to be maybe exhorted or challenged in as it comes to being more Christ-centered in our approach of interactions and of relationships?
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
I feel like there's a few breakdowns that we can go into. Mm-hmm. Like, we can do like parent to parent, you know, parent to child, child to parent, you know, child, you know, there's a lot of different relational aspects in the family, I guess. You know, I think I'll just start probably talking about, you know, parent, mm-hmm. you know, my wife and I, we've been married now for a little over 2 years.
Amen.
Man, and it's been a journey, a great journey, and I wouldn't choose anybody else. She's awesome. And through that, we have just learned so much about how to love each other, you know, even more and more and more as we've grown in our relationship. And as Pastor talked about, if you didn't watch the podcast with Pastor, please go back and watch. That was a great podcast. Just listening to his wisdom on relationships and loving, and he really delves into, so I'm not going to go too deep in this, but like, he really delves into what it's like to love your spouse and care for your spouse and to be there for them and to serve them and how that works. But man, like, this has been something that Kayla and I have really been continuing to grow in and will grow in for the rest of our lives. But it's just, it's so important to, because you have your relationship with God and then you have your relationship with your spouse. And that's your number two relationship that you are to pour into and invest into. One thing that my parents did that I really, really loved, but hated it as a child, but I love it today, is that they would come with a unified front. So whatever, you know, whatever decision mom said, dad would back mom up. My dad had this lovely phrase that I absolutely hated. Oh, so did you talk to your mom about that yet?
That's right.
No, I didn't. I just talked to you about that. That's kind of the point. Mom said no. But no, I mean, come with that unified front. There's just little things that, like, in that relationship from you know, parent to parent that I think is important.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
And I think that parent to child is also worth mentioning, because we also are at a point where a lot of people will prioritize that over everything else. And so we've almost made our children, and I say our, as a culture, into the idol, right? Our child is our idol. And that is who we are, you know, bending over backwards for day after day, killing ourselves, trying to, obsessing over the worldview of our child. Right. And that is kind of a hard pill to swallow when you realize none of that matters.
Do you think the obsession is more with the soul, or do you think it's more with, like, others, like, perception? Or, like, what do you think?
My perception of people's perception
is the perception thing, right?
And it's more about, because here's the thing. I've even had my own child tell me that I was nicer when people were over.
Right.
And then why is that? Well, because sometimes we parent differently when other people are watching. And that's something that I think. Well, honestly.
That's my wife.
No, just in Gabe Zavala, perfect pair.
Something I've gotten much better about since she said that to me, and I realized, gosh, that's really unfair, and also kind of terrible that she noticed that, and like that was a gut check or a heart check or whatever. And it goes back to my relationship with Jesus, and it's like, well, why am I getting so anxious about her behavior with or without people around? Why is it different? The expectation always has to be the same, and that goes back to what is our heart like, and what is our foundation like. So I think that when we take them off that pedestal, so to speak, and we see them as someone that we are put in charge of growing under Christ and teaching them and showing them Christ's love, that takes a world of stress off our shoulders. We don't have to create the path for them. We don't have to come up with the perfect plan for their life. We're not responsible for them achieving that perfect plan. We are responsible for loving them and teaching them about God and to love, and helping them to know and love God and showing them what that looks like.
Yeah, 100%. And I love that by you doing so, in essence, you're also teaching them what a healthy marriage looks like.
Yeah.
That the world doesn't take a lot for a child, right, to start thinking, man, the world revolves around me. You kind of mentioned that a few minutes ago, right?
Yeah.
That from the moment they're babies, they know all they would care for is what they want.
Right.
Right. Their worldview is already about themselves. They're the center of the world.
Right.
The last thing we need to do as parents is to affirm that even by our choice of parenting or our style, parenting.
Yes.
I think we need to give them a healthy picture of what a biblical, healthy marriage looks like. That at the end of the day, mom and dad are a team.
Right.
Why are they a team? Right. They have been tasked with this command to teach them to grow in the admonition of the Lord. And that's their primary job. And yet, look, I've been there where I have parented my child depending on my surrounding of the people who are around me.
Yeah.
Like in my house, I'm Sergeant Pastor Gabe. Around people, I am grace giving, mercy, kindness, driver, Pastor Gabe. And that's just, right, that changes. And it shouldn't, because then what we're also exemplifying, and again, guilty, is that depending on your surrounding, you can change who you are.
Right, right.
And that based our identity on people rather than where you're supposed to be, which is on God.
Right.
And the same thing goes with their relationship with other kids. You know, I try to teach my kids, look, like, when you play with other kids, be kind, think about them. Like, don't have this self-centered view of just everything is all the toys are for me. All the toys are for me. Not saying that there's a point where you do have, again, healthy balance there. But I think it's easier for a child to think more about themselves than others. That's not a general full statement for every child.
Right.
But statistically speaking,
in general,
it's easier for a kid to think, I want that toy now. rather maybe looking at the situation and say, you know what, do I really need that toy? Or what if I use that toy as an opportunity to love this kid or even teach them, right?
Yeah.
What a beautiful picture for a child to teach another child, hey, I'm going to share with you.
Yeah.
I'm choosing to be kind and loving to you by sharing this toy, right?
So there's a lot of work to be done in everyone, right? And I'm a very checklist-driven type person. I mean, I'm still the person, yes, I have my smartphone, but I have physical checklists that I write in. And I feel like a lot of times there's a temptation to, when I do this, then I'll be able to do that. Once I get this right, then I can do that. And so the question that comes up is like, well, where do you focus? Because, and the answer, in my opinion, is all of it. And the change happens all at once. When you start changing your heart and you grow with God, all of that. And this ridiculous visual came into my mind. Do you guys remember carnival games? And they're, well, and maybe even some like Dave and Buster's or whatever, but there's the
I'm not that young, Aaron. I knew what a carnival game is.
I was the fault of you.
You all at Florida remember carnival games. And there's like the, you put the quarter in, and then there's like the ledge of quarters, and then there's the, you
pile.
Right? Yeah, so right. It's, think of like, all of it as being, it's all getting pushed at one time. All of it.
Right.
You can't just push this one section that has the buildup of quarters. You have to, it's all just, and then the quarters will start to flow and you'll get richer in love and peace as the quarters fall.
Man, come on, Eileen. Come on. No, absolutely. Well, and I want to piggyback off that. Like, you're related, again, back to the beginning. And we would just, this is our emphasis, is your relationship with God is what drives all of this. And ultimately, I remember when I was a youth, I was really struggling with, you know, an issue, and I was like, man, if I could just get this issue figured out, if I could just work through this, then I'd just be fine, right? Then I tried. But really, I'd separated myself from my devotions. I'd separated myself from prayer. I'd separated myself from reading the Bible. And so basically, I was like trying to run a race without hydrating, you know? And so it was like, and ultimately, like, I was burnt out. And I got to a point where I was like, God, I am so sorry I've neglected you. I'm so sorry. And listen, have I had struggles since then? Absolutely. We all have struggles, but this is a daily decision, a morning by morning decision. This morning, am I gonna wake up and am I gonna serve God? Am I gonna put God first in my life? If I gonna prioritize His Word? You know, the best place to start a pattern is not tomorrow; it's today. And so if you start those patterns as a parent, you know, tonight you're like, man, well, where do I start with family worship with my kids? Where do I start with, you know, reading the Bible? Well, there's an app called the YouVersion Bible app. And, you know, on there are some good materials that you can start with, you know, some devotionals. My wife and I are going through a 365 day, like through the Bible devotional right now. And we're really enjoying it. You know, we listen to it on our way to work, 30-minute commute. You know, we're just listening to it. It's a great start to the day. It doesn't take me, you know, outside of my normal routine, or, you know, there's ways to embed that in your culture.
Yeah.
Our culture, you know, your rhythms that you're already doing, you know, instead of having to say, well, man, I got to wake up an extra 30 minutes early, but I've already gone to bed an extra 2 hours late, you know. You don't got to do that. You just working into your already there rhythms, you know.
Oh, and actually, you know, kind of following through with what you said too, in the YouVersion, you have different devotions for kids. Like we actually use different apps, but we have used YouVersion where there's a family devotional. The kids love videos, right? And I know we're going to be careful in how much technology and video we push to our kids. But let's say that you feel like, man, I just don't know what story to tell or whatever the case may be. Well, here you're provided with an avenue where you can show a video about a Bible story. And just have some conversation. Hey, what did you hear when you listen to this video?
Yeah.
Like, what was the coolest thing you saw? Like, what was it that jumped out at you? And just have those conversations, because what you don't realize is that you're basing upon the truth of God, and you're literally just positing truth upon your child, and that's what's going to, at the end of the day, make the true change. So here's my question, right? So we talked about the gospel. How is that driven in our discipleship rhythms? What that looks like applicationally. Well, as we end, what are some questions that we can ask that are self-assessment questions, right? Because at the end of the day, we don't want you just to be a listener. We want you to be actively engaging this content.
Right.
What are some questions that our listeners, our parents, whoever is listening, can ask themselves when it comes to how do they apply the truths that we talked about today upon their lives?
I feel like there's some with spiritual disciplines here. I feel like there's something with, you know, it's like in the Bible, it says that a good tree is going to produce good fruit. And a tree that's not planted in good soil, it's not going to produce good fruit. And so a way that we can gauge kind of, you know, where we're at is like, you know, where are we at with our own, you know, spiritual disciplines? I know that's what I do, is like whenever I'm not in God's word as much as I would like to be, you know, I start to notice things in my life that start to slide. And then I'm like, you know, okay, let's back up. Am I doing my devotions? No, I haven't been doing them for a few days. Okay, I need to get back into that and do that. Maybe assessing sort of those things. That might be something to just stand back and look at. Okay, how am I doing in my spiritual disciplines? Prayer, reading the Bible, you know, fasting and meditating on God's word. Not a weird way, just like, you know, meditating on what God's word says, thinking about it, pondering it, you know. How am I doing with that?
Yeah.
You know?
I think asking yourself, and maybe for some of you, writing it out would be helpful. But what is my relationship like with my kids currently? And what do I think my relationship should be like with my children? So that contrast sometimes can be quite stark when we realize, well, my child is the decision maker in my house. Not mine. I'll be very clear. Not mine. But maybe that's how you feel. And maybe that's not, I mean, we know that that should not be the case unless it's their birthday and they get to pick the ice cream or the cake or something, but they need us to make those decisions. And while it should not feel like a dictatorship in your house, and you want to include your child in specific, but it should be intentional decision-making that you're allowing them, not the expectation that it's their way always, right? So what does that relationship look like? What do we want it to look like? And I think, you know, when you're taking your own relationship with God and understanding that, you know, you could ask that same question about your spouse. And I think we could definitely, you know, this is the family ministry podcast, not the marriage podcast.
But
there are so many resources out there for just understanding that and just know that that relationship cannot be underestimated. So maybe the question is that we can all ponder is where do I start, right? If I feel like I'm pushing all the quarters and like really where do I actually start? And I think it goes back to just that foundational piece, right?
Fair.
And if you have questions and you have like, well, gosh, I'm really struggling with this, we would absolutely love to hear from you. I think following up on those questions and those struggles is also something that we want to start folding in and incorporating into these episodes, because it's really important that we know whether or not we're reaching, are we hitting the, you know, the current topics and pain points. And just going in and reading that scripture, Matthew 27, 30.
No, you're right, 22.
Okay, second guess myself. Matthew 22, 37 through 40, you know, go in and read and really just take a few quiet moments, which feel impossible sometimes. I know just as much as probably many of you, but it's really important.
And I just want to end as well, and Ms. Erin basically said it, is, you know, if you feel like, where should I start? And those questions are so good for you who has a relationship with Jesus already, right? Asking, where do you fall in your disciplines, in your spiritual disciplines? Where do you fall as a parent? You know, maybe asking your child, hey, how do you view me, right? Which is a scary thing to ask a child, but like, how do you view mommy and daddy, right? And have a fun activity with that, by the way. Don't make them feel guilty by their response. So I would say be careful, because I've been guilty of this, where my face will have a response to their answer, right? Ask them, be careful with that.
For littles, like, it would be good, even just do like a temperature gauge, right? Like, ooh, yeah. You think that I'm like, here or here, right. Am I like, where do I fall? Because so then they don't have to come up with the words, right? Because maybe they don't even know. But if you say like, I'll give you this. This is really fun to listen to. My daughter was into making these pot holders with the loom,
mm-hmm.
and she made this very colorful.
She made one of those for Miss Kaylee.
Oh yes. Well, did hers have a black line through it?
Uh oh.
The black line was my meanness. Apparently, and there was a smaller side of the pot holder and a larger side. They wasn't directly in the middle. And I asked her which side was the nice side, and she wouldn't tell me. So I figured it out.
I think she told you.
This was she didn't say it, but she told me. This was a couple of years ago. And you know, all of these little moments where if you're not,
I know you're perfect. I can, right? You know, no.
I don't know why I do this. I don't even know why I come here for this.
So I will say, that I think kind of going back to the closing of all this is, right, that is all if you have a relationship with Jesus.
Right.
So I want to step forward and say for all of our listeners that maybe you're listening to this, and maybe as you're thinking through it, as you're listening our words and are, you know, yogging around and all that stuff, you're realizing, maybe I don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, right? Maybe that my relationship with other people are not the way they're supposed to, because I don't even have a relationship with the Savior Jesus Christ. And I want to call you on that and say, today's the day, like Pastor Jonathan said, you have an opportunity right now where truth is opening your eyes to that reality that you have, that we are all born into this world as sinners. There's nothing we can do to attain salvation aside from the work of Jesus Christ, that for us to have a healthy relationship with our Creator, who is God, the redeeming work of Jesus has to permeate, has to save us, has to just wash us of all of our iniquities, all of our sin. And all we have to do is to acknowledge on all reality that we're sinners. We need to confess that Jesus Christ is indeed Lord and Savior, and accept that truth and trust, not just know it, but trust in that truth. Ask for forgiveness. And the Bible says that all those who call on the name of the Lord shall be forgiven, and you will be forgiven. Because here's the real thing at the end of the day. If you don't have that, all of this will matter. If your relationship with Jesus Christ is not the way it's supposed to, and that starts by the gospel, then all that we said sounds like good stuff, but it's going to be impossible. Because at the end of the day, all of us can do those things because of the work of Jesus Christ, and because we have the greatest helper we can have, which is the Holy Spirit in us, who's the one who's actually doing all the work at the end of the day. We're just vessels, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Like, our children get to know and trust the Lord. I pray that we will be obedient to that, but that is the work of God. Right. That is the work of God through the work of the Holy Spirit. And I just pray that if that is you today, man, make the decision. Just trust in Jesus. Confess your sins and know that you will be forgiven. And we would love, if you want to reach out or you have any other questions, or maybe you're like, okay, I hear that, but I have some other things that I want to tackle. We would love to hear from you. You can email, you know, Gave, GaveZavala, at fbfirst.com. You can email us. You can email the church. You can call the church, whatever mechanism you can to reach us. We would love to hear from you, to walk with you, because at the end of the day, we don't do this just to have some video content. We do this because we want to be obedient to the call to proclaim God's truth.
Yeah, that's right.
Specifically to the family, I understand that. But at the end of the day, we want all those who hear the gospel call to answer their call.
Right.
And that's why we're here. So,
if I can piggyback on that, maybe you've accepted Christ and maybe you know the truth, but maybe you are not implementing the truth. And I would say that, you know, 17-year-old Aaron met and developed that relationship and I got saved and baptized and all of that, and lived to be a good person after that, whatever that meant, right? And potholder mom Aaron was not walking with Christ at that time. And so maybe you're in a situation where you've accepted Christ and you feel like you're good. You know you're going to heaven, but life is still really hard. It doesn't have to be. It really doesn't have to be. And so you're looking at renewing your faith and walking that path more closely. That, I think, is something that probably more people are in that boat than would want to admit and realize. And so those daily rhythms and habits is how you really start to grow in that. But yeah, if we can help you in any way, please reach us.
Oh, I was just going to say, families, it's been so great having you on the podcast today. Our mission here is to equip families for life with God's truth. We hope we have equipped you today, and we'll see you whenever we see you next time. You guys have a good week.
Thank you.
Peace.
Take care.